education centers near you.
The People's Court, weekday mornings at 10 on News Channel 6.
Well, just a handful of showers around today, and that's going to be changing, though, as we go through Friday for the weekend. With some very heavy rain likely, we'll detail your full 5 or 6 forecast and what to expect coming up. Right now on News Channel 6 at 5, a man in custody accused of shooting and killing his wife. Today we hear from neighbors about the crime.
Plus, a new opioid abuse prevention program could help curb overdoses in Edgefield County.
And Augusta commissioners meeting to talk about whether to make a new millage rate increase official or keep it the same or roll it back. What did they decide as your News at 5 starts now?
Live from Television Park, this is WJBF News Channel 6 at 5.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Jenny Montgomery.
I'm Brad Means. We do thank you for joining us today.
Coverage you can count on begins with a developing story. Queen Elizabeth II, Britain's longest reigning monarch, has died at age 96. She spent 7 decades on the throne. The palace reports the queen died peacefully at her summer estate at Balmoral in Scotland. The queen's successor is Charles, her oldest son. Winston Churchill was her first prime minister when she ascended the throne in 1952. At age 25, she met her 15th prime minister just 2 days ago.
It is a day of great loss, but Queen Elizabeth II leaves a great legacy. Today, the crown passes, as it has done for more than 1,000 years, to our new monarch, our new head of state, His Majesty, King Charles III.
The Queen's funeral will take place 10 days from now, following a national period of mourning. ABC News will be continuing coverage of Queen Elizabeth's death beginning at 6:30 on World News Tonight and then again at 8 p.m.
Did you know the royal family has some pretty strong historical ties to Augusta? And we talked to Nancy Glazer at the Augusta Museum of History, and she told us about the historical connection between London and the Garden City. A connection that's chronicled at the museum through pictures and artifacts.
Actually, the town itself, Augusta, is named after Princess Augusta, who married into the family. She was originally from Germany, but she married into the family. She married the Prince of Wales, Frederick.
And you see the collection there, sure to get a lot more attention after the death of the Queen. The Augusta Museum of History, located at the corner of 6th and Reynolds Streets, downtown.
It is time now for a first check of our forecast.
Jenny Brett. All right, Tim, thank you. The GBI investigating that deadly shooting in Thompson that we told you about yesterday. Jim Wilson accused in the murder of his wife, Sue. Tonight, neighbors are reacting to what happened as News Channel 6's Bria Smith reports.
Neighbors say they're shocked to hear what investigators say happened at this home. The Wilsons were well known in Thompson and McDuffie County. Neighbors say the couple seemed happy.
I've known the man. He's very sweet. We didn't think nothing like that could happen to somebody that we knew.
Ronald Randolph says he spent some time working on the Wilsons' land at Pine Top Horse Trials.
I've done some work for Glenn Wilson. I've done some work for him on farm. And he's very nice, him and his wife.
People we spoke with in the area say they're sad to hear about what happened. And while the GBI continues its investigation, they're left wondering exactly what led up to those fatal shots.
It's something that people are going to be questioning, because we've had friends of us, our family, my family, ask if we've known what happened, and we just found out about it when it first happened.
In Thompson, Bria Smith, WJBF, News Channel 6. One person is in the hospital after a shooting in Richmond County. It happened around 10:30 last night on Murphy Road. That's off Milledgeville Road. Police say the victim was last listed in critical condition. No suspects have been named.
Well, property tax rates in Augusta are now set, but not producer Danielle Casale confirming the Senate has not voted on it.
Mental health groups in the Aiken area are doing all they can to lower suicide rates and take away the stigma of mental health care. The Aiken Barnwell Suicide Coalition hosted its third suicide prevention summit today. A report from 2020 shows Aiken County has the second highest suicide rate in the Palmetto State. And the CDC says there's a death by suicide roughly every 11 minutes in this country. The goal of the summit is to bring various mental health groups together to bring awareness to suicide prevention strategies.
Our world is a desperate place and people are seeking help. And I think that this is just a perfect way to give people the tools that they need to reach out to people that are in crisis.
If you or a loved one is struggling with suicide thoughts, call 988. That's the National Suicide and Crisis Lifeline.
And happening tonight, Golden Harvest Food Bank giving away produce. They're giving away that free food again tonight, 5:30 to 7:30. At the Faith Food Factory on Commerce Drive off Gordon Highway. Just show up with an empty trunk. They'll put some food in it for you.
Coming up, Republican senators are working to block the Biden administration's student loan forgiveness plan.
We're going to have an update on why they're working to make sure the plan does not take effect as it currently stands when we come back. CarMax, let's have a conversation.
Welcome back, everyone. Republicans are eyeing lawsuits to block President Biden's student loan forgiveness plan.
Yeah, we've been checking out this story for the past few days, then calling the plan an illegal overreach and abuse of power by the executive branch. Here's Raquel Martin.
Republican lawmakers say they want to see President Biden's student loan forgiveness plan blocked in the courts.
But there's no authority for the president to wave a wand and to forgive billions of dollars of student loan debt, and yet he did it anyway.
Missouri Republican Senator Josh Hawley and Iowa Senator Chuck Grassley say they welcome lawsuits that would stop the plan before it goes into effect this winter.
This would really be a tremendous win for the fight against inflation. It'd be a tremendous win against the unfairness that it brings to people that don't go to college, to pay for people to go to college.
But the White House contends the president is on solid legal ground and is still encouraging Americans to apply for forgiveness next month. Illinois Senator Tammy Duckworth says Republicans are wrong to try and undercut this relief.
Why would they want to keep this financial burden on the backs of so many young graduates and so many middle-class families?
But not all Democrats are coming to the president's defense.
I just don't think that the Band-Aid approach works.
Michigan Democratic Congresswoman Alyssa Slotkin says it's up to Congress, not the White House, to decide how to help students.
The legislative branch is the one that appropriates money, and this was a decision taken by the executive branch. That's not common.
No lawsuits have been filed yet, but the Attorney General of Arizona is hinting he and other AGs could take action soon. In Washington, Raquel Martin.
A new Bitcoin mining facility is opening up in Wilkes County. It's going to be run by Clean Sparks, and they're going to have a site in Washington. A lot of job opportunities are coming with this. What they do is make sure that Bitcoin transactions run smoothly and sustainably. The site specifically is used for Bitcoin coding, and it's run off very high-end computer systems.
CleanSpark uses predominantly low-carbon energy, which is really key to making this network run, because the social utility of Bitcoin, like what it does, this is a new kind of money. It can change people's lives.
We certainly welcome Clean Sparks to our community. They held their ribbon-cutting ceremony today to celebrate that opening.
Coming up, Chief Meteorologist Tim Miller's back next with your Viper 6 forecast.
He'll check out the weekend outlook for us and cruise in California. Meanwhile, wish they had all the rain coming our way. Those wildfires raging. Stay with us. I'm returning tomorrow. I'm going to continue to watch Saturday. If the models continue to give us a decent amount of rain with all that's going on, we may issue an alert to guys coming up for Saturday. Right now, where it won't, just get ready for the rain. Keep an eye on it, okay? Thank you, Tim. Now to California, where extreme heat is forcing people to conserve power. They didn't want to have any rolling blackouts out there. The heat's also a big factor in 9 major wildfires. They've torched more than 30,000 acres across the state. More than 1,000 homes are still under evacuation from the Fairview fire. And in Big Bear Lake, the Radford fire has now exploded to nearly 1,000 acres.
There's basically no moisture in the vegetation, so we're seeing the fire just having exponential fire growth.
Meanwhile, the panic over record-breaking demand caused at least one utility to mistakenly cut power in several cities. Widespread blackouts are still a threat.
Coming up, the city of Thompson is preparing for the famous Blind Willie McTell Music Festival.
Always a big event. Tonight we're learning a lot more about Willie McTell himself, the namesake of that festival. We're going to have a special look next.
Call 222-HURT right now.
This month, the city of Thompson will host its famous Blind Willie McTell Music Festival. So who is Blind Willie?
In this month's Hometown History, News Channel 6's Kim Vickers shares more about the traveling blues player.
Blind Willie McTell was born William Samuel McTeer in the Happy Valley community of Thompson at the turn of the 20th century. He was born blind, though it's unclear if he was totally blind at birth or fully lost his sight later in childhood. McTell was born into a family of musicians and, as a teenager, taught himself to play his signature instrument, the 12-string guitar. He was known for his clear, soulful tenor voice and intricate guitar picking style. After the death of his mother, he left his hometown to become a traveling street musician, playing a unique mix of country blues, ragtime, gospel, and popular music.
Calling him a blues player really is kind of a misnomer. He was a street musician, basically. And so anything that would make money drop into his cup while he was playing on the street is what he played.
The Blind Willie McTell Music Festival will be held Saturday, September 24th. To learn more about Blind Willie, just head on over to WJBF.com and find the story. Kim Vickers, WJBF, News Channel 6.
We're back at 6, but count on more coverage of the day's top stories on News Channel 6 at 5:30.
Dee Griffin joins us now with more on what's coming up ahead.
Thanks so much, Brad and Jenny. Reaction continues to pour in over the death of Queen Elizabeth II. We are taking a look back at the life and legacy of British's longest-serving